Good morning and welcome at this Open Infrastructure Summit Shanghai. So I'm delighted to present you today a session around machine learning benchmarking with OpenStack on Kubernetes. So quick introduction, I'm Erwan Galen, product manager at Red Hat, working mainly on hybrid cloud on the hybrid cloud computing on the AI. So today we will discuss of machine learning and why you need benchmarking for machine learning. I will present a new standard of benchmark suite, MLPerf, on how you can apply these types of benchmark for your own platforms. So machine learning is everywhere. So every phone, every computer is using machine learning or deep learning. So my computer can recognize my head, and also Queen Elizabeth. It's more easy to find her. But also when I'm traveling, I can use translation. So translation is using a lot of machine learning. So I don't know what is this sentence, but the computer know. Is it good? Yeah, good. But also, companies are investing a lot on machine learning, for example, for fraud detection. It's key for companies to detect fraud, and they are hiring hundreds of data scientists to manage fraud detection. You will also find machine learning and deep learning for self-driving car. Tesla is using a lot of this computing, and also for retail and e-commerce, like recommendation engine for Amazon for movies. So before machine learning, the benchmark were more oriented around CPU. It's more easy if you have just to benchmark and to identify what are the limits of one CPU. So there was lots of standard to benchmark CPU. But there is an explosion of software on the hardware solution. These explosions also help and has created this new revolution of machine learning. So currently, GPU are driving the power of machine learning. So the two main boards provided by NVIDIA, so the Tesla V100 and the Tesla T4. So one more dedicated for training and another one dedicated for inferencing. But we start to see other type of hardware accelerators like FPGA from Intel or for Xilinx. So these type of accelerators are more dedicated for inferencing and also for edge with low power. We can find also some ASICs like VPU. Google is providing some TPU and Intel has created with Movidius the Myriad, which is a chip, an ASIC, that can be used also for data center and for servers. So plenty of hardware and also plenty of software stack to enable machine learning. So NVIDIA is leading this market mainly with CUDA, so CUDA cores and the software stack CUDA. Also with some technology to link the GPU with NVLink or NVSwitch. And also a set of drivers to enable the GPU, but also libraries to use with your application. On the full integration with many platforms like OpenStack. So for OpenStack, you can use pass-through, but also there is a development of vGPU with a new profile vGPU compute server to be able to share one physical GPU into multiple GPU. But also for Kubernetes, with integration with device plugin for done by NVIDIA. So at the end, if we take an example of ResNet 50 model, we can see that for the use case of inferencing, we can increase the throughput by 47. So it's quite huge. Compared to a classic CPU, it's 40 times faster. So it's not only adapters, but when you want to run workloads at scale and when it do not fit in the memory of only one adapter, you can use dedicated GPU accelerated servers. So it's just a selection. You have plenty of them, but The king on the first one was the DGX-1 with 8 V100. We have seen the V100 before. So on the last big one, the DGX-2 with 16 V100. But also you can find other types of server. All these servers are using the same GPU, but you can put different numbers on the cards are connected with memory interconnect. So why do you need machine learning benchmarking? So if we take the classic pipeline, so you start to ingest some data and to prepare the data. So here, the data engineers are working on this topic. So CPU are enough for this first step of preparing the data. But after, when you want to produce a model, you need some GPU for the training, so call it training. And after, you will have to deploy this model. It could be deployed in a central place, in data center, or remotely at edge. So for this, we can still use CPU, or we can use the same boards or dedicated boards that are a little bit more small, low power, like the T4. So, but you have to take care that it's not only GPU. Lots of use cases, CPU can be enough. So, machine learning presents a high number of challenges. So, it's compared to classic computing, you have a ton of parameters, hyperparameters. So, it's not only one simple application consuming some hardware. Because you are using models, it's very hard to reproduce and to have zero variance when you are running a workload. So we really need an industry standard to try to measure and try to compare multiple hardware with multiple software stacks. So it's a little bit complex, but here we are speaking of OpenStack and OpenShift. So OpenShift is a Red Hat distribution integrating Kubernetes. So if we start with our layer, we have seen CPUs, GPUs, or FPGA. On top of it, managed in the platform of OpenStack. Inside, you are deploying an OpenShift Kubernetes cluster. You have your Kubernetes namespace, Kubernetes pod, Kubernetes container, and you can run your application. After, in your application, you can use some machine learning frameworks and a set of parameters to apply to a machine learning algorithm. So in fact, you need to monitor all these things to be able to compare systems. So it's really hard because you have all the stacks. And also, there is a high dependency with operating system, depending of type of container, libraries, machine learning libraries, of math libraries. So in the history of benchmarking, so there is spec. So spec was more oriented to run binaries for to compare CPU. Trying to get the peak performance, but peak performance for machine learning do not have too much sense. One of the first interesting benchmark was produced by Harvard University. It was called FATOM. And also, this university has contributed to multiple other benchmark suites. So very interesting benchmark, but it was an 8 fixed model. So the issue to use only one model is machine learning is evolving every day. So if you just fix your monitoring suite to only a limited set of models, you are blocked, and it will be outdated after multiple months. So after, there is multiple benchmark suite, just saying Baidu DeepBench, more oriented to monitor hardware, and after Stanford DownBench, HPU Deep Learning, on the training benchmark for DNN. And one of the most interesting cloud suite, the last one, is MLPerf, with a first iteration 0.5. So MLPerf, we said that we have to monitor the full stack. So if you only monitor, you take a data set. So a data set, if you take ImageNet, it's, for example, some cat or some dog, it's a set of image with labels. So if you take a data set and you said, I want to have this target quality of identification, if you do not fix the model, you cannot compare one system with another system. So in fact, it's mandatory to define which is your model of your training. So MLPerf is defining and has made some choices about defining and fixing the model and fixing parameters. So in fact, there is a list of models, and you are applying exactly these models. So it's a main division called closed division, but also there is an open division, and there is not too much submissions, but it's also available if you need to, if you want to use specific hardware and to encourage innovation. There is also an open division, but the main division of MLPerf is closed division with fixed model on the fixed data format. So MLPerf was created initially by Harvard, Baidu, and Google and Berkeley. And there is two main sets, the training and inferencing. So training is already ready. It's the second iteration. So currently the result V06. On inference, the results have been submitted but not yet published. So they will be published in the coming weeks. So the goal of MLPerf is to accelerate the progress of machine learning, but also to enable a fair comparison. If we took the other cloud suite, some of them were very specific for commercial use, but MLPerf is open for academia and also for companies. So it will measure the system performance of training and inferencing. It's not dedicated only for data center to use with platform. It can also be used, for example, for mobile phones or for cloud platforms. And the main target is to run a script, and this script will run in a certain amount of time. So if you run during 1 minute, you are better than a script that will run in 1 hour. So the goal is to run the same test and to do a small time. And also, there is some measurement of the power. It's optional, but there is some benchmark that can measure the power and also the cost. So here are the submission rounds. So the first result of V05 of training were available December last year. This year, the second round on inference is coming here. So the idea is to have new results every 6 months. It's what I was saying, compared to the previous benchmark suite that were blocked on a fixed set of models, you can have some updates of new models, on new targets, or any new thing to run for a new cycle. So MLPerf is pretty new, so there is not yet like OpenStack Foundation, an organization, but next year, the MLPerf should create a foundation, Zurich Foundation. It will be called ML Commons, and there is already 40 companies and 18 members for this community. So for training, there is a selection of data sets and models. So it's a choice. So there is seven benchmarks. So three benchmarks for vision, mainly working with ResNet 50, ResNet 34, on MaskR CNN. Two benchmarks for translation, English to German. One for recommendation engine, and the last one for reinforcement learning around Go, MiniGo. So the six first benchmarks are more used with GPU, and the last one can be useful to monitor CPUs. So if we compare the two releases of MLPerf V05 and V06, we can see that MLPerf has increased the target quality. So it's the same benchmark, but for example, for V05, the quality for ResNet 50 was increased from 74.9 to 75.9. So it means that it takes more time to run the same benchmark during the two iterations. So you can find all the results of on mlpf.org, and you will see that you will find some data center things like Google TPU, but also DGX. Some results are only for one adapter, one server, or it could be a set of lots of servers. So one of the biggest is 130 DGX1, so it's a lot, and with a total of 1,040 V100 boards. So it's quite a big deployment. So some examples of results. So NVIDIA is also contributing to this test on the for example, Minigo run in 13 minutes. So if you run it with one adapter, for example, object detection, it's 3 hours. You can run it also the same code. It's a Docker file. You can run it on your platform, and you can compare, and perhaps you will identify that you have some issue on your own platform. So Red Hat also is contributing to this effort, and we have created an open community called the Open Data Hub project. So this community provides some resources high end-to-end. And one of these resources are a set of MLPerf containers for UBI, and so you can directly use some containers in this project and test MLPerf. You will also find lots of operators to run Jupyter Hub or to run many AI use cases. So we have done one set of run with Supermicro. So this is a screenshot of Grafana dashboard, or each line is one GPU. So it was with this server with 8 Tesla V100 GPU boards. And these results were published online. And the result was, in fact, like NVIDIA with a DGX1, some of the benchmarks were a little bit better, and some of them was a little bit under. So it was between 0.05 to 6.13 slower. We compare to NVIDIA, it's quite the same. We have run 4 benchmarks. So these results were not published. On the same, Dell has done his own set of tests, so not published. And Dell was more comparing the one adapter, not only one server. We can see that when we take one adapter or 4 adapters, it's not multiplying by 4. So it means that it's very interesting to compare the full solution with all the board, and not only checking one board and multiplying by the number of board. Because it's very interesting to see that it's important to monitor the complete solution. So we have seen the training part, but also there is a new family in MLPerf community, the inferencing. So for inferencing, it's a completely different set of testing with 4 main scenarios. So the first one is single stream. So it means that, like a cell phone, when you use your phone, it's live, so we'll measure latency, trying to identify objects very quickly. A second set of scenarios, a multiple stream. If you take an edge server that is connected to multiple camera, how many streams I can manage? A third test, which is more close to OpenShift and OpenStack inferencing, it's a server where you will try to put a central site and you will measure the query per second of a platform. And the last scenario is offline, more a batch mode when you are, for example, sorting pictures on photo. So for each of these scenarios, you have some latency targets, and you can run in specific context. So same compared to training, you have also a selection of models. It's mainly around ImageNet dataset and also COCO dataset. And we find quite the same models, ResNet 50, MobileNet. So MobileNet is more light, so it's more usable for inferencing. So there is already some submitters who have contributed. So the results are not yet public, but you will find that NVIDIA, Inspire, Google, Facebook are contributing to these results. So some people are here. You have submitted? So quick example of a run. So there is a Docker file, so you can run the Docker file, or you can also deploy the library. So for inferencing, you can choose the type of scenario. So here it's with the scenario single stream, and you can run it on the full data set of ImageNet or a selection of a subset of this data set. So now if we want to look with OpenStack on OpenShift, we must enable on OpenStack, if we want to monitor GPU, we must enable GPU. So one of the most simple use of GPU is to use pass-through, is supported since quite the beginning of OpenStack. So pass-through is via KVM direct access to the PCI board, and it's only adding a flag to a flavor, and you can consume a GPU. You can attach multiple GPU to one virtual machine. But also there is a new feature, vGPU, that works with NVIDIA grid driver. So with this driver, you can, in fact, it's like vCPU. You can slice a physical GPU into multiple GPU. So this thing is not really useful for training, because training, you need the maximum power. But for inferencing, it could be interesting for some platforms to use vGPUs. Same if you want to enable GPU for Kubernetes. So you will have to update and to add a set of drivers for your Kubernetes cluster. So first starting at the operating system. So for us, we are using RHEL, or for the last OpenShift release, 4.2, we are using RHEL CoreOS. On top of it, we enable the CUDA drivers. We are using the Cryo runtime, not the Docker runtime, with some plugin. At the level of a container, the container integrates the CUDA toolkit, and we can put the modeling libs. And Red Hat has developed some operators to enable quickly GPU on a Kubernetes cluster, OpenShift. So first, so operator will manage a life cycle of the configuration of your cluster. So a first operator called node feature discovery. So with this operator, you can tag your nodes. So it mainly it will look if you find a PCI ID of NVIDIA, for example. And after getting a tag, another operator called special resource operator will enable the whole stack on your compute node, installing CUDA, the plugin, the Kubernetes device plugin, and also we are installing a monitoring Prometheus code. So at the end, we have an OpenStack running. And with OpenShift, there is a direct integration between OpenShift installer. And with one command, you can deploy a full OpenShift cluster on OpenStack. It will create the virtual machine just running one line of installer. So if we take an OpenStack cluster, it creates three masters for Kubernetes. Here we have created three workers, classic workers for CPU, and one worker dedicated for GPU. And after, we can also get the nodes with Kubernetes. So when we run VMs on OpenStack, we have to take care of NUMA Affinity, because this is a CPU on memory. It's called a NUMA node. But also, when you attach a PCI device, like a GPU board, this PCI device is also only attached to one NUMA node. So you have to take care of plugging the board in the good slot, and to identify if run a job on the good NUMA node. Because if you run a job on one NUMA node and you will use a PCI device in another NUMA node, you can lose some performance. So you can do some PCI commands to check this. And by default, OpenStack is trying to schedule only on the good NUMA node. So when you want now to test your OpenStack on Kubernetes platform, there is a quick test you can run. So it's a benchmark provided by TensorFlow. So this benchmark is very simple, very quick. You can create your own Docker. So here it's an example of a pod description of benchmark GPU. So it's only cloning the TensorFlow and running it with, here we enable one GPU. And because we have enabled on the VM GPU with pass-through, this driver is available in the Kubernetes cluster, and we can run it. So it's a simple job you can run and get some results. So for example, here, with one V100 with TensorFlow 114, we were able to run for GPU 325 images per second. So it's training. And with CPU, it was only 2.24. So really a huge difference using GPU to analyze. And also, there is another software solution you can use to monitor and to analyze your platform on the code. So it's called Tote. So it's an open source project, and Bedat is contributing to this open source project. So when we take two frameworks, so one framework, which is TensorFlow, and we use Flask to run this framework. So we do a code in Python. So import TensorFlow, from Flask, import Flask. So this simple command. In fact, you can have lots of versions of TensorFlow, so 49 releases, and also 29 releases. So just running this command, you can have some combination of first 59 by 28, so 1,000 combination. But if you look after the dependencies of Flask, not Flash, you will find that you are running 54 million of combination. And after, when you add the dependencies of TensorFlow, it's I don't know how many, but it's a lot. So it means that when you are running your application, so you can monitor your hardware, you can monitor your platform, but for your software stack, you can also make some mistake or take some libraries that are not giving you the good performance. So in fact, it's very important, like platform. When you decide for a platform to update and take the new version of RHEL, for example, you are doing some staging and you are validating your platform in a previously by a running test. So same for machine learning, it's key to identify and to be able to compare your stack before putting your application in production. So to run Tote, so it's an open source project. So as I said, it shows that it's not good always to take the last version of the libraries. So because lots of developers and data scientists are using pip or are getting packages from everywhere, but it's not enough. You must qualify each component, and also with Tote, you can do some micro benchmark to identify component by component. So Tote is mainly working with Python, but Python is the most used language. And Tote will be able to create a knowledge base. So there is multiple components in Tote. You have a Tote Station server, and you can qualify the quality of a build on the quality of runs. So this example, one of the components is called Tamos. So you go in a repository, and you just run this command, Tamos advice. With this command, Tote will analyze your code and will find the dependencies and will analyze. And you will store this data in your server. So if we compare Tote with other solutions, Tote will allow you to evaluate the performance indicator for the software stack. So specifically for the software stack, it will produce the time to run on the floating operation, and it can be used for training and inferencing. So it's good to add this type of monitoring if you can do it, not only monitoring the full stack, but also trying to keep the history of your software stack. So Tote also will try to use algorithm decomposition. So it means that if you take a machine learning algorithm, you can divide this this general algorithm into multiple parts, multiple operations, multiple types, and multiple basic mathematical operations. So using this tool, you can really go in detail. So I think just to start with Toad, because there is a lot of tools, you can just start with Tamos. If you are using Python, that will give you insights, but also you can really go deeper with this type of algorithm decomposition. So with Toad, you can run tests for this part if you run the advisor from Toad, but also you can run at different level of your application. So for example, in Red Hat team, we are producing a TensorFlow optimized. So we are using internally this tool. So using this tool with TensorFlow, we have seen that we can have a lot of combination with TensorFlow. So using this tool, we can produce a TensorFlow compared to the PyPy TensorFlow package. And we can compare the performance in milliseconds or operation per seconds. So the Red Hat one is red, so we can see that we have higher performance because we only pick the good versions of libraries usable. So other tools or other platform like NGC containers of NVIDIA also are taking care of performance, but you can use this type of tool for your own platform to compare the performance of your tooling. So you can detect before going in production that you have an issue on your platform because you are storing data and you can compare the performance. You see that it's very, very interesting. All right, so key takeaways of this presentation. So we have seen that MLPerf was taking care of a full stack of the platform. So you don't need to monitor only the hardware like Spec was doing, but monitoring the whole stack, starting from the hardware, from the libraries, using a specific model, and also with fixed parameters and hyperparameters. NVIDIA is leading hardware and software libraries, so there is some new players, but NVIDIA is key, and we have seen that most of the servers with accelerators are based on NVIDIA and NVIDIA V100. So MLPerf is starting to be a standard, and we can call it an agile standard because there is some updates every 6 months. So it's not only fixed on a set of models, but it's updated with new targets, new models. For some use cases, we spoke a lot of GPU, but perhaps you don't need GPU. For inferencing, CPU can be enough. When you are using OpenStack and virtualization, you have to take care, and also for a classic operating system, you have to take care of NUMA affinity, because it could decrease your performance by 30%. It could depend of a use case. Because there is lots of version of the GPU driver, you have also to use certified driver because we can have some lack of performance if you are not using certified driver and tested driver for Kubernetes. You can use MLPerf for your own platforms. So it's very interesting to have some results of MLPerf and run the same Docker file on your platform with the same data set, and you can compare with a submission from NVIDIA or from Google. You can also run some quick benchmark. So one example was with a TensorFlow benchmark, and not use the last libraries. Try to monitor what you are putting in production. And if you can, so you can use some your own tool, but using Toad, you can create your own benchmarking with your own knowledge base for machine learning performance. That's it. Thanks. If you have some question. Okay, so I'm available if you need and if you have some questions. Thank you.